So good morning everyone. Today let us discuss mathematics of asymmetric encryption. We are discussing about CNS and we are discussing unit 3. In unit 3 already we have seen what is the introduction of unit 3 and then what is RSA algorithm. Now we are seeing mathematics of asymmetric encryption. So what is that? Mathematics of asymmetric encryption. So we know what is symmetric encryption, we know what are the symmetric algorithms, we know RSA is asymmetric algorithm, and we know what is asymmetric encryption also. So in cryptography we are using the concept of keys to provide security. So what I told you in the earlier classes, if you are using only one key, that is secret key, then that is called as symmetric encryption. If you are using two different keys, public key and private key, then that is called as asymmetric encryption. Now as a part of unit 3 we have discussed everything like RSA algorithm, what is asymmetric encryption, why we are going for asymmetric encryption, then what is Chinese reminder theorem, all these things you already know. Mathematics of asymmetric encryption is the last topic of unit 3. So once we will see what happened from first unit, second unit and third unit, then we will see what is the mathematics, so that we will complete the three units of CNS. So first we have started, cryptography is a Greek word, and now we are using cryptography to provide security for our data. Every day we are having lots and lots amount of data. We are generating data, we are saving the data, we are generating the data, we are transferring the data, everything in the world is around the data. Now to provide security for the data is our concern. So how we can provide security for the data? We have different methods. For that we are taking the help of cryptography. So in cryptography what we have so many methods. We can use cryptographic techniques, we can use cryptographic algorithms. Later on when you move on for fourth unit and fifth unit, you can use the concept of key management, Kerberos, message authentication codes, like this. So many different methods and so many different techniques we have, different approaches we have to provide security for our data. But as of now we are in the earliest part of cryptography, so we know only what is the attack, what is the service, what is the mechanism, what are the keys, and if you are using one key it is symmetric encryption, if you are using two or different keys it is asymmetric encryption. So as of now we know only using algorithms to provide security for our data. So to provide security for our data we can have n number of approaches. We can have firewalls concept, we can have Kerberos, message authentication codes, we can have some protocols, same way we can have some algorithms also. So initially we are learning about algorithms, later on we will know what are the other methods to provide security for the data. So as of now you know what is the DES algorithm, you know what is the AES algorithm. So these both will come under symmetric encryption because there we are using only one single key. Here we use the concept of two different keys, public key and private key, and example for that is RSA algorithm, you also know that. So till now we have learned the basics of cryptography and network security. What is data? What are the attacks on the data? If this attack happened, how we can solve it? So we are in unit 3. So if we discuss mathematics of asymmetric encryption, our unit 3 will be completed. So before to this what we have discussed? As a part of mathematics of asymmetric encryption, first we have to see what are the prime numbers. So what is Fermat theorem, what is Euler's rule, then what are the prime numbers, how you can check the primality of a number. If these you learn, that will come under mathematics of asymmetric encryption. So you know there is a data and there is a problem for data also. To solve that problem we are taking the help of cryptography. Now in cryptography we have different approaches. In that now we are in a stage that we are using either symmetric or asymmetric algorithms. So as a part of that, to finish unit 3, the last topic is mathematics of asymmetric encryption. So now, what is a prime number? First, as you already know, how you can divide a prime number? Prime number is divisible by only itself and 1. So a number, if you consider n as a number, n can be prime number if n is divisible by 1 and itself. So this is the simple rule you already know from past. So first point in mathematics of asymmetric encryption is prime numbers. So what is the definition for prime numbers? A number n should be a prime number if it is divisible by itself and 1. So now total positive integers can be divided into any positive integer can be divided into 3 groups. So that is exactly divisible by 1, having 2 divisors, having more than 2 divisors. So if you have integers or if you have positive integers or if you have any numbers in this world, all that positive integers or all that numbers can be divided into 3 groups. First one is exactly having only 1 divisor. Second one is having 2 divisors. You already know what is divisor, dividend, remainder and quotient. You people already know what is the remainder, what is the quotient, then what is the integer, quotient, remainder, integer and dividend, you already know. While talking about symmetric encryption mathematics in unit 2, we have already discussed this. In unit 2 of cryptography, while talking about mathematics of symmetric encryption, we have spoke about division rule. While talking about division rule, you already know what is the dividend, what is the divisor, what is quotient and what is remainder. So all the positive integers in this world can be divided into 3 types. First one is exactly having 1 divisor, second one is having 2 divisors and third one is having more than 2 divisors. More than 2 divisors. So all the numbers in this world can be divided into 3 types, having exactly 1 divisor, number having more than 2 divisors and number having 2 divisors. Now, so what is the second point in mathematics of asymmetric encryption? Into how many types the numbers are divided? So, while discussing about the mathematics of symmetric encryption in unit 2, you already know the division rule. So, in the division rule, you know what is a divisor. So, the first point is all the positive integers are divided into 3 types. And the second point is prime numbers. Prime numbers can be divided as number. If n is considered as a prime number, it should be divisible by itself and 1. So these are the first two points in mathematics of asymmetric encryption. Now we want to tell, if we want to check whether n is the prime number or not, checking the primeness of a number. So checking the primeness of a number, this is the third point. So let us see. So now, so third point is checking primeness of a number. So for this you have, see, if n is the number, n should be divisible by all primes less than, n should be divisible by all primes less than root n. So this is the rule for checking primeness of a number. N is the number, you should find square root of n. If you have taken n is the number, you should find square root of n. So my number is 9. If you think my number is 9, I should find the square root of 9. Right? The value of n is 9. First, then I have to find square root of 9. Nothing but square root of 9 you need to find. Then if you want to check the primeness of any number, n should be divisible by all the primes less than root 10. So find the square root of n. And find the prime numbers less than root n. and all the prime numbers which are less than root 10 should divide this n. That is the rule for checking primeness. So first point is, what is prime number definition? Second point is, into how many times the positive integers are divided. Third point is, how you can check the primeness of a number. If n is the number, immediately you have to find square root of n, and you have to find all the prime numbers which are less than square root of n. If all the prime numbers which are less than square root of n are also dividing the n, then n is the prime number. So if we see example, you will understand. So if you see example, we'll see the example now for checking the primeness, then you will understand. So example for checking primeness. So first let us take 97. So n equal to 97 I have taken. I have to find square root of n. So square root of 97 nothing but square root of 97 is nothing but 9. Okay. Now, what are the primes below 9? Primes below 9 are 2, 3, 5, 7. Now, what is the condition? If you have taken the n value, after finding the square root of n, you should find the prime numbers below the square root of n. The prime numbers are 2, 3, 5, 7. Now, what do you want to check? All the 2, 3, 5, 7 also should divide this 97 should be divisible by all these numbers also. So 97 is not divisible by all of these, only few will divide. So 97 is not a prime number. So these and all, when we move on to 4th unit and 5th unit, and when we move on to algorithms, in algorithms we will get all these things. So in the mathematics part, they are including all these things. So if you want to check the primeness of any number, first take the number, find the square root of the number, then find the prime numbers which are below the square root value of that. Then all the prime numbers below the square root value also should divide the n. If that is not possible, then it is not the prime number. So here 2, 3, 5, 7, all of these will not divide 97. So 97 is not a prime. We'll see one more example. So let us see one more example, 301. My n value is 301. Then square root of n will be square root of 301. So what is the value of square root of n? 17. So what are the prime numbers that are less than 17? 2, 3, 5, 7, 11, 13, 17. So now 2, 3, 5 will not divide this 17. So 301 is not a prime number. Not a prime number. So first point, a prime number is defined as it should be divisible by 1 and itself. Second point, all the positive integers are divided into 3 types, having exactly 1 divisor, having 2 divisors, and having more than 2 divisors. Third point, you want to check the primeness of a number. Further, you have taken a number. To check the primeness, what is the rule? You should find square root of n, square root of that number, and the value what you got after finding the square root, you should find the less than prime numbers to that. So I have taken 301, square root of 301 is 17. So the prime numbers below 17 are 2, 3, 5, 7, 11, 13 and 17. And now all of these also should divide 301. But it is not possible, 2, 3, 5 will not divide 301. So 301 is not a prime number. This is the third point, checking the primeness. So next one. So the next one is Euler theorem. So the fourth point in this is, so the fourth point in this, see, Euler's function This Euler's function is also called as Euler's pi function, and it can also be called as Euler's totient function, and it is denoted with pi of n. So the fourth point in mathematics of asymmetric encryption is Euler's function. It can also be called as pi function or totient function. It is denoted with pi of n. So now what are the points we have in this? So pi of 1 equal to 0, pi of p equal to p minus 1. P is the prime number here. P is a prime number. So now onwards we will use the prime number frequently. So before we discuss what is the prime, in Euler theorem, Fermat theorem and upcoming theorems also, algorithms also, we are going to use the word prime number. So till now we have discussed what is the prime number and how we can check the primeness. So first point in this is pi of 1 equal to 0. Second point is pi of p equal to p minus 1. And finally third point is pi of m into n equal to pi of m into pi of n. Here m and n are relatively prime numbers. M and n are relatively prime to each other. Relatively prime to each other. And finally, fourth point. So what is the fourth point we have? Pi of p power e equal to p power e minus 1. So here also p is the prime number. Here also p is the prime number. So next one, fourth point is Euler's function. Euler's function is also called as Euler's phi function and Euler's totient function. This is denoted with, as I said, you phi of n, we will denote that. So what is the first one? Phi of 1 equal to 0. These and all are predefined statements. We will use these statements while we are solving the algorithms. So I have already told you, discussed you about what is the prime number. So here pi of p equal to p minus 1, where p is the prime number. Same way, pi of product, these two are also relatively prime numbers. M and n are also relatively prime numbers. So pi of that relatively prime numbers product is equal to pi of individual relative prime numbers product. And finally, powers. So prime number to the power e equal to p power e minus p power e minus 1. So these four are the predefined statements. So these four are the predefined statements we are going to use from the Euler's totient function. Simply we can call it Euler's function or Euler's totient function, represented with pi of n. So we already discussed about prime numbers. Now some predefined statements we are using, as we use the predefined statements in division rule. So these statements we will use while solving the algorithms. So pi of 1 is 0, pi of p is p minus 1, where p is the prime number, pi of m into n equal to pi of m into pi of n. So m and n are relatively prime numbers. These two, m and m, n, are relatively prime to each other. And finally, pi of p power e equal to p power e minus p power e minus 1. So next we will see Fermat rule. Next one is Fermat little theorem or Fermat rule. Fermat's little theorem. This is simply also called as Fermat's rule. So this is the fifth point in our mathematics of symmetric encryption. What is the prime number? How to check the primality? Then what is the pi coefficient? Then what are the positive integers are divided? 4 points. Then fifth point is Fermat little theorem or Fermat rule. Fifth point in mathematics of asymmetric encryption. What it says? If p is the prime number and a is any integer in this world and p does not divide a, then according to the scientist Fermat, then he proposed a rule, a of p minus 1 congruent to 1 mod p, or a power p congruent to a mod p. So these two are the statements stated by Fermat. So fifth point in mathematics of asymmetric encryption is Fermat's little theorem. It is also called as Fermat rule. Here we are considering two things. So first one, any prime number. Second one, any integer. In this world, if you have any prime number and any integer, when that prime number does not divide that integer, if you consider any two numbers, one should be prime and one should be integer. And the condition is that prime number is not able to divide this integer. Then in that case, if the prime number is not able to divide the integer, then in that case, you have to use the two statements like integer, a is the integer, p is the prime number. So a power p minus 1 congruent to, this is the congruent symbol, 1 mod p, or else a power p is congruent to a mod p. This is the Fermat rule, fifth point. So what is the prime number definition? Have to check the primality, then Euler's quotient, totient functions. Then in this world, all the integers are divided into three types based on the divisors. Then finally, Fermat's little rule. It is also called as Fermat's little theorem. So what this Fermat is going to tell? In this world, if you consider one prime number and one integer, when that prime number cannot divide this integer, then you can use the statements a power p congruent to a mod p. And finally, sixth point. One last point we have in mathematics of asymmetric encryption. So one last point we have, that is sixth. So Euler's theorem. Euler's theorem. If we discuss this Euler's theorem, mathematics of asymmetric encryption will be completed. Euler is also a scientist. What according to the Euler? See, if you have, if a comma n are the coprimes, if a comma n are the coprimes, then a of pi of n, a power pi of n congruent to 1 mod n. This theorem is used to find the multiplicative inverses. This Euler's theorem is used to find multiplicative inverses. So if you want to find multiplicative inverse of anything, Euler's theorem is used. What is the statement of Euler's theorem? As I already told you, according to the Euler quotient, pi of n we are using to represent anything related to Euler. So if a and n are coprimes, then a of pi of n congruent to 1 mod n. And this Euler's theorem is mainly used to find the multiplicative inverses. So see here, 6 points we have in mathematics of asymmetric encryption. Prime number which is divisible by 1 and itself. To check the primality, you need to find the square root of n. Then you need to find the prime numbers below the square root value of n. Then all the prime numbers should divide that n value. Then only we can call it prime number. That is the checking of primeness. Next, in this world, all the positive integers are divided based on the divisors. Having exactly one divisor, having two divisors, and having more than two divisors. Then we have some Euler totient rules. Like pi of p equal to p minus 1, pi of 1 equal to 0, all these things. Then pi of m into n equal to pi of m into pi of n, all these things. Then what is the Fermat little rule? Fermat little rule is nothing but if you have two numbers and one is the prime number, another one is the integer, when that prime number cannot divide this integer, then you have the two statements. Then finally, Euler's theorem. Euler's theorem is nothing but we are having two numbers a comma n which are coprimes, and this Euler's theorem is mainly used to find the multiplicative inverses. For that we have the statement a of pi of n congruent to 1 mod n. So this is the mathematics of asymmetric encryption. Next we will discuss Rabin's crypto systems. Next one is Rabin's next algorithm is Rabin crypto systems. RAB in crypto systems. So see, in unit 3 we have mathematics of asymmetric encryption. In that 6 points we have discussed. Next we have RSA algorithm, that also we have finished. Then we have the topic like asymmetric crypto systems or asymmetric encryptions. In that we need to study about RAB in crypto systems. So let us see the algorithm of RAB in crypto systems first. It is same as RSA, but E value and D value are constant. So what is the rule in RAB in crypto systems? Like RSA algorithm, RAB in crypto systems is also a algorithm. Why we are discussing this algorithm? It is not part of your syllabus, but in case if they ask under the concept of asymmetric encryption, if they ask for that, we are discussing RAB in crypto system. Rabin is the scientist. Now what is the difference between this RAB in crypto systems and RSA? Both RSA algorithm and RAB in crypto systems are same, but the value of E and D in RAB in crypto systems is made constant in RSA. We have the E value and D value. These both values are made constant in RAB in crypto systems. So let us see what is the algorithm. So RAB in crypto systems, so what we have to take, we have to choose P, Q, which are large prime numbers. This is why we are talking about prime numbers always. In RSA we have two prime numbers P, Q. In RAB in crypto systems we have two prime numbers P, Q. This is why we have spoke about prime numbers in mathematics of asymmetric encryption. So you have to choose two prime numbers, large prime numbers P, Q. Then you have to find the value of n, nothing but the product of the two large prime numbers. So we don't have the E value or D value in RAB in crypto systems, it is constant. So we don't need to find any E value, we don't need to find any D value. So directly we should have two types of keys. What is the public key? Public key is n. So private key we will have, private key is Q, n. So finally what we should do, we should return P, Q. By this our RAB in crypto systems will end. See, RSA is also an algorithm, RAB in crypto systems is also an algorithm. This RAB in crypto systems was invented by the scientist Rabin. So what is the difference between these two algorithms? In RSA we have the value of E and D that we made constant in RAB in crypto systems. Now what we have to do? We have to choose two large prime numbers P and Q, and we have to find the n value, nothing but product of P and Q. In any algorithm we are talking about asymmetric encryption, so we should have public key and private key both. So our public key is n, which we have found by multiplicating P and Q. So our private key is Q, n. So Q value here already we have, so n we will compute here. So this is RAB in crypto system, selecting two prime numbers, finding the value of n by making multiplication of P and Q. Then public key is n, private key is Q, n. Then what is the ciphertext and plaintext in RAB in crypto systems? C is the ciphertext. For finding ciphertext, what formula we have? C equal to P square mod n. So P is the plaintext. So for finding plaintext, what formula we have? Square root of C mod n. So ciphertext equal to plain text square mod n, plain text equal to square root of ciphertext mod n. So P is the large prime number, Q is the large prime number, we only decided. Then we have found the value of n by multiplicating P and Q. Then public key is n, private key is Q, n. So we can return the P value and Q value and N value also. This is RAB in crypto systems. But ultimately we need to find ciphertext and plain text. Ciphertext is denoted with C, plain text is denoted with P. So to find ciphertext, what formula we have? Ciphertext equal to square root of plain text, I mean plain text square mod N. Same way plain text equal to square root of ciphertext mod N. This N value we will get here. So n equal to P into Q, P and Q are two large prime numbers, n value we only computed. So after computing the n value, we can find the ciphertext by p square mod n. We can find the plain text by square root of c mod n. Now we'll see the example for rabbit crypto systems. So we will see the example for rabbit crypto system so that we can conclude mathematics of asymmetric encryption. So example for Rabin crypto systems. So first you have to select P, Q. P and Q are large prime numbers. So selecting P as 23, Q as 7, because they both are prime numbers. Next, find, compute the n value, n equal to p into q. So computing the n value, n equal to p into q. So we will get the n value 161. So what we have to do, we have to decide public key. Public key is n. So here public key is 161. Next, private key. So what is the private key? Q comma n. So here private key 7 comma 161. Till here you got by algorithm. So rabbit crypto systems is also an algorithm. Here we will not have e value and d value. So we have selected two prime numbers like 23 and 7. Then we have computed the n value like 161. Then public key is n. So public key is 161. Private key is q comma n. So private key is 7 comma 161. So now what are the formulas we have for ciphertext? P square mod n. For plain text, square root of ciphertext mod n. These two are the formulas we have. So if we compute, what we'll get? Plain text we'll get as 24. So now what we can find the ciphertext? Ciphertext equal to 24 square mod n. Nothing but 24 square. What is the square root of 24? 576 mod 161. Nothing but 93. So C value you got as 93. You have to substitute this C value in the P formula. Then you have to cross check. First, I assumed plain text will be 24, because 24 will be the relative prime number for 23, 7 and 161. So I have taken 23 and 7, I have computed the product 161, then I have designed public key and private key. Then I assumed the value of P, which will be a relative prime to 161. Relative prime. So my assumed P value should be a relative prime number to n value. So n value 161, relative prime number for that will be 24. So what I have done, I have substituted in the formulas E equal to P square mod n. To find ciphertext, I have the formula C equal to P square mod n. In that formula, I have substituted P value and n value and I got the C value as 93. Now this P value is assumed by me. I need to cross check whether that P value is correct or not. For that, what I have to do, we have the formula. See, p value is correct or not, we have to see. P equal to square root of c mod n. So p equal to square root of 93 mod n. P equal to square root of 93 mod 161, which is nothing but p equal to 24. So we have got the plain text as 24. We have got the ciphertext as 93. RSA is also an algorithm. Rabbit crypto systems is also an algorithm. But in RSA, we will have the value of e and b. But in Rabbit crypto systems, we don't have E value or D value. Those are constant. So first you have to select two prime numbers, large prime numbers P and Q. So by making the 23 and 7 are my large prime numbers. So I have to compute the N value by product of P into Q. So N equal to 23 into 7, 161. So public key is N. So public key is 161. Private key is Q comma I. So private key is 7 comma 161 because Q value is 7. Now what I have to do, by using the formulas C equal to P square mod n and P equal to square root of mod C mod n. By using these two, I have to find the ciphertext and plain text. So what I did, I have assumed the plain text as 24 because 24 is the relative prime number for 161. Then I have substituted. Square root of 24 is 576. 576 mod 161 is 93. Now I have to check whether this 193 and 24 are correct values or not. For that I have substituted this C value in the formula for P. So what is the formula we have for plain text? P equal to square root of C mod n. So I have substituted the 93 value here in the place of C. So 90 square root of 93 mod 161, I got P value as 24. So by this rapid recursive system is also completed. So with this we will complete unit 3 in CLS.
Okay, madam.